If you have your Bibles, if you would open up to Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 6. I'm going to read the first four verses, then I'm going to go to 19 through 24, and then the 33rd verse. And what we're going to talk about today is where your heart is. I used to hear this commercial on the radio all the time. It was Heart Check America. And every time I would hear that commercial, I would think, I wonder how I'm doing. You know, there's some heart trouble in my family. And then I would say, I wonder if I should go there, you know, because they make all these claims that they can, predict if you're going to have a heart attack and things like that. So I asked my doctor, and he said, I don't think you need to go there. Don't worry about it. I said, okay, all right. And then recently I looked them up, and I see that they're having all kinds of problems with their business. And I was thinking, okay, Lord, what about that? And then I realized what God wanted to say to me is, Jesus is the real heart checker. And this morning, I believe you're at Heart Check America spiritually. And he's going to go after your heart in a place that you probably wish he might leave alone. And so with that, I'm going to begin reading those first four verses. Jesus says, "Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you." The words of Jesus. Turn now to verse 19. Now we're going to talk about your treasures. "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. And if then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." Verse 33, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given you as well." Father, I ask you to come in the precious name of Jesus, and that, Lord, you would reveal yourself to us, you would reveal your plan to us today in Jesus' precious name. Amen. If you're following in your outline, the first point, acts of righteousness should be done to please God, not man. I'd like to back up first and say acts of righteousness should be done. Because some of you might be going, what's he talking about? I've been taking care of myself fine. What's he want? And the point is, Jesus says you should do this. You should give of yourself. Now think about the world that we live in. Is there an attitude of this in our nation? I'm here to tell you that if the church is having the influence we should have, there should be acts of righteousness and generosity being done constantly. Oftentimes I'm asking the Lord, Lord, is our nation in the place financially that we are because you want us to check our hearts? Then if you do acts of righteousness, it's to be done to please God, not man. If we do them to please men and the people around us, Jesus said, you have your reward. That's it. The next point, motive differentiates between hypocrites and God's children. Oh. Why do we do what we do? Our motive is so important. Do we only do things that will benefit us? Or do we give freely? You see, I think our church is fabulous. And we have people that give, and we have people with awesome hearts, and we're debt-free. But I also see all that we could do if we had. And the key is our motive. Why do we do what we do? I love it. There's an old biography about D.L. Moody, and it says he went and he spoke in this place, and when he walked out of the building, the men outside were asking him, "What do you want? Why do you do what you do? Do you want money? Do you want fame? What are you here for? Why are you preaching the gospel constantly?" I love his answer. You know what his answer was? He said, "I'm after souls. I want souls." His answer wasn't, "Oh, I need to get rich. I need you to promote this. I need that. I want to be famous." He's all of those things on top of it, isn't he? But he said, "I want souls." It's time for the church to start winning souls. I'm here to tell you, we won't win a soul if our motive is wrong. If our motive's right, we will see an amazing harvest of souls. The next point in your outline, gives secretly to an audience of one. Give secretly so that God knows what you've done. Whether you buy 10 chairs or no chairs, we're still going to let you sit on a chair if you come. I thought you'd like that. And at the same time, we're not going to put your name on the chair. Because if we put your name on your chair, do you see what Jesus says? Then you have your reward. That's it. That's it. And Jesus' words just reach out and they grab your heart. He says, if you do this just for men to see, and if you want recognition, then you have your reward. Your next point, bank your reward on earth with man or in heaven with God. What are you going to do? What do we live for? Before I was saved, I lived just for me. I just wanted to get rich. I wanted to have stuff. But when you meet Jesus, it all shifts. And where do you bank? What are you doing? The entire world right now is trembling over their money and their stuff. Verses 19 through 21 talk about our stuff. Look at Jesus. He says, "Do not store up for yourselves treasure on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. Store up for yourselves treasure in heaven." What are we working for? What are we trying to acquire? In your notes, banked rewards on earth are vulnerable to loss. You can lose things so quickly. This is probably going to surprise you, but there was a country song in 2006. And George Strait had this song, and he was having trouble in his marriage. I think the song takes in the whole Sermon on the Mount, if you really listen. And his wife was trying to walk away, and she was going to leave. And he said, "Wait a minute." He said, "What do we do with all our stuff?" You know what the chorus of the song was? "Just give it away." What about that picture? Give it away. What about our bed and all our furniture? Give it away. It says she threw her diamond ring at him. And he said, now, wait a minute. Don't you want your half of everything? And she said, give it away. It's not worth fighting for. How many marriages break up over stuff? Just give it away. You know what the sad line of that song is? He said, but I can't give it away. Couldn't let go. We have such a problem with our stuff, and we hang on to it, and it's so vulnerable, and sometimes God will sweep it away to get our attention. And if we get the lesson and if our heart's in the right place, he won't sweep your stuff away. He'll give you more and more. The more you get rid of and give, the more he'll bring back. You can't outgive him. But our logic doesn't work that way. We're like, no, I have to hang on. No, don't hang on. Look at your next point. Banked rewards in heaven are eternally safe. Lay up for yourself treasure in heaven. But you know what our problem is? We don't see it. God doesn't send me a statement going, hey, pastor, you know, you got this much stored up here. I'm like, yeah. He doesn't do that. But I remind people about it all the time because they do things and they get no reward. As a matter of fact, they spend their gas and their time and their own money to help, and they get nothing. And I tell them, do you realize your reward in heaven is so awesome because God sees? I love it when people give and they say, hey, I don't want anybody to know. Here, just take this, use it. It's amazing. I learned such a great lesson from my dad. I was always going, Dad, you know, I want a new mini bike. I want this. I want that. Dad, please. And he would say, ah, your old one's good enough. I'd say, gosh, I wish we were rich. And he would say, you know what? Rich people aren't even as happy as we are. Oh, Dad, what are you talking about? You got to be kidding me. He said, they're so worried about keeping what they have. And he told me, he said, I work for them. I do work for them, and they're miserable. Trying to hang on. And it all has to do with where their heart is. Look at your next point. Earthly interests and passions locate one's heart. Where's your heart today? What are your passions? Now, this is painful for me, but I'm going to take you with me. Okay, go back through your life and find out where were your passions and interest. Whew. I'm only going back so far. Junior high. Girls! I'm in church, I can't lie. I mean, you try to think about other stuff, you know? Girls. By the time I got into high school, it was girls. Sports. Because sports could get you girls. Hear what the scripture says. It says, where your treasure is there, your heart will be. Do you realize how bad I needed the Proverbs back then? To teach me. Then I graduated into cars. Cool, car would get you girls. Whew. Oh, did I need a wife?